I'm Victoria Mullen with WKTV Voices, and we are here with Lisa Enos today, a filmmaker who is just awesome, who happens to be female, and she's going to talk about, you know, her experiences and other things as well. Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Awesome. I feel privileged to be here, actually.
Oh, well. You mentioned before we started that you're from Ludington originally.
Yeah, I grew up in the country on 40 acres in a place called Riverton Township, kind of cherry, like cherry country.
Cherry country.
Yeah, I said I grew up in a cherry orchard, but we had a little family farm, a hobby farm. My parents weren't farmers. My dad was actually from Chicago, so that was my, I guess, idyllic childhood.
That's awesome.
About 4 miles from Lake Michigan, so.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Do you have siblings?
I do. I have 3 older brothers, much older. I was kind of an afterthought. Hmm. So while they kind of were born in Chicago or spent some of their formative years there, I was pretty much raised in Michigan. I lived in Ludington since I was 8 months old. So.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. Well, until I went away to college at 17, I went to Michigan State. I wanted to study acting, theater, but I took a few theater classes at college, and I realized what I really liked about theater more than like the acting classes was the technical theater classes. Those were kind of required for people who were trying to get into the school of theater or whatever they called it there. That was my first like kind of foray into any kind of art classes, because where I went to school, I went to Mason County Central, a very small school, and I graduated with 100 people. We didn't have art class. We didn't have anything that was even remotely considered art class. I mean, there might have been like home ec, and you might have learned to sew or something like that, but there was nothing that taught you even the foundations of art, so I had nothing. I had no previous exposure to any of the arts besides being in school plays. And we had a wonderful theater program where I went to school. We had some pretty cool people come out of my high school. People have gone on to international fame, like Maynard Keenan of Tool, and another drummer named Brian Burwell, who is a great musician, lives out in LA. Harold Cronk is another film director, graduated from my high school. So out of this really small kind of what we were always made fun of being like a cow town. We've had some pretty cool people who've gone on to do great things out of my school. And these are people who are like kind of right in my age group. So anyway, back to Michigan State, I started taking technical theater classes and found that I liked building sets. I liked learning about like the different colors and moods and the lighting, and I think I did sound. You know, just the different things that you do and the technical side of things. And I pretty much, you know, gave up acting after my freshman year of college. And not really gave it up. I didn't make any big announcement, like, but I kind of just went the other way, you know, like back, you know, behind the scenes. Cut to like a year and a half later, my father dropped dead of a heart attack. And I didn't have any financial support. He didn't really prepare anything for that. It was just out of the blue. He was like 56, 57 years old. So my older brother, who had also graduated from Michigan State, kind of sat me down and said, what are you doing with your life? You need to get a practical degree. So I graduated with a business degree from Michigan State University, which was no easy task. I wasn't great at math, you know, wasn't great at it, but I got my grades up. I got into the school, you know, the Eli Broad College of Business, graduated after, it took me 6 years. I had some complications. I got in a car accident, had a head injury. I had to drop out for a little while, kind of relearn to read a little bit. And then my mom, my senior year, what would have been my senior year, was diagnosed with breast cancer. And so there were a lot of trips out of town to hospitals and that kind of thing. So I got a little bit behind in graduating from college. So I spent 6 years in East Lansing, and right after college I moved to Chicago. And about my first week there, I met somebody who owned a really small production company. He had worked for John Hughes Productions as a production assistant. He worked on like Curly Sue and Home Alone, Lost in New York. You know, kind of a big deal for somebody who, I'd never met anybody who knew anybody who made films before, you know? So, and he was doing very boring, like rudimentary, like educational videos. Care of Children's Teeth is the name of the first video I ever worked on. And I was hired as an illustrator because I can kind of draw, kind of sketch. And from there, two of his partners left Chicago and left him with like a workload, and I moved right into like a producerial role for the company and started making small like children's films, narrative films for classroom distribution on emotional, kids' emotional well-being. It was like things like, I think the name of the series is called Life Lessons 2. When Things Don't Go My Way, The Problem with Problems. These are all like awesome. The names of videos. And we were, you know, hiring kids, casting kids, and adults. You know, somebody would have to play a teacher or a mom or whatever. And I started writing and directing all the way back then, and that was the 90s. We moved the company to Portland, Oregon, where we had more support in the digital realm because Chicago was pretty steeped in union hiring practices at the time. That was like mid-90s. So in 1995, moved to Portland, Oregon, where people were kind of more embracing of new technologies. Instead of the Silicon Valley, they called it the Silicon Forest up there, you know, between Seattle and Portland. It was kind of a burgeoning hub of I don't know, technology. And people embracing technology and new technology. So I kind of got in on filmmaking, digital filmmaking on the ground floor. I made the first digital film to ever air on A&E Network in 1996. The film was shot, 96, 97. It was a documentary about a woman who had saved 54 children by hiding them in her barracks at concentration camp Bergen-Belsen. Now I wrote the script for it. It's a documentary, so it's kind of like I wrote what Bill Curtis, you know, I wrote his narration, and he wasn't involved in the movie until after it was finished. And we just kind of did a scratch track of the narration and then sent it to Curtis Productions, and then, you know, he did this Bill Curtis, you know, his thing. His stand-up thing.
Right.
And that was pretty cool. I was all of like 25 or I think 25 years old when I did that. I took a crew of 5 people, including myself, to Europe. We tracked down the survivors, the kids who had been in the concentration camp. I interviewed the survivors. You know, we edited on our Macintosh on Adobe Premiere. Did the offline edit. This was like in the late 90s, so like I said, I really did get in on the ground floor of things, and I did it for, you know, pretty successfully for years. I ended up moving to Los Angeles in 1998 and immediately started work on a script that would become my first feature film that I produced and co-wrote. That was called Ivan's Ecstasy, and set out. I'd been to the Sundance Film Festival in around like 1996 when I was still looking for funding for The Angel of Bergen-Belsen, and I got it. And I saw a couple of films that were independent, didn't have any stars in them, and were just kind of fun little quirky films. And I was like, wow, I want to do that. Make a narrative film that's like a feature-length film. And so Ivan's Ecstasy was born. Got some good cast in it. Our lead was Danny Houston, who had never had a lead role before. He'd done a few bit parts, like I think but he's gone on to be a pretty big movie star, and that kind of has raised the cachet of that film over the years. I was really lucky because right out of the gate, you know, I was working and working daily and one project after another, back to back, until birth of my second child. And even then, I mean, I still was making films up until he, I think, made the last feature film when he was one. He turned one. There was a horror film that I produced and starred in Romania. And my son turned one in the hotel room in Romania. So that's how I gauge, you know, that's how I figure out when things happen in my life. Now it's by the birth of, you know, milestones, like childbirth and things. Mm-hmm. After that, everything kind of just slowed down. I mean, the film it was like an art film about horror movies rather than a horror film. And so it kind of disappointed horror film fans, unless they were big fans of like older horror movies. They were really horror aficionados. They understood all the references in the film. And if they were just kind of like the new breed of like youngsters who wanted to be scared, they kind of just didn't get it. But nonetheless, it opened at the Edinburgh Film Festival. So it's not like it was a total flop. And it opened up in major theaters in London where I was living at the time. And it was kind of cool.
What's the name of the film?
It's called... it has a very unfortunate title of Snuff-Movie.
Okay.
it was called Man with a Movie Camera. It was called Man with a Movie Camera during production, and Lionsgate put it out, and they decided to go with... The movie within the movie was called Snuff Movie, and they decided to make that the title of our film. And I just think it was a wrong move. Sorry, Lionsgate, if you're listening, but, you know, it's
people
like...
People are probably expecting something totally
different. Yeah, they're expecting something totally different, where Man with the Movie Camera was an homage to a Russian film. I won't go there, but anyway. I don't even want to get talking about the Russians right now, so we'll just leave it at that.
Okay.
I pretty much glossed over my whole career so far. Do you have any questions?
Well, okay, in L.A., tell me what it's like to be a female filmmaker in L.A. I understand that it can be a lot of obstacles, or maybe you didn't feel that, I don't know.
You know what, to be honest, I felt no gender issues in L.A. or in London. In London, they're very used to female producers. I think there are more female producers than male producers in England, I've heard. I don't know. I mean, I'm not positive what the stats are, but it's not uncommon for females to be producers. Mm-hmm. Same in LA. I knew other female filmmakers. Directors, not as many, obviously. What is it, like 4% of studio films are directed by women? Mm-hmm. But a cool fact is that my producing partners on Snuff Movie also produced Monster, which Patty Jenkins directed, and Patty Jenkins, of course, did Wonder Woman. So these were people, Donald Kushner and Brad Wyman and Peter Locke, they had no issue working with me as a female producer. I didn't direct the film for them, but, you know, they'd obviously worked very successfully with Patty in Monster with Charlize Theron. So, and I think Patty did a shout out to Brad Wyman, my producing partner, at the Oscars 1 year. Was it her? I don't know. I should probably go check this stuff. But I don't know. I didn't find it as difficult as working, I hate to say it, as a female in the Midwest.
Really?
I've had some pretty bad experiences in the past year and a half of working on a crew. Like last year, you know, I young people on my crew I'm not going to name any names, young males who had come up out of film school, but, you know, I was barking directions the way that, you know, that directors do. And right. We're outside and there's waves crashing and this, and apparently I was told that my AD was going behind my back, and like, you know, it's just, I'm like, really? And this is a kid just out of Grand Valley. And I had another, my AD argued with me, another kid right out of Grand Valley. Oh, he might be like 26 now or something, but arguing with me about, you can't shoot that here. We shot the other scene, you know, you can't shoot that by this tree. We shot the other scene that, you know, dovetails with it, half mile away by that other tree. And I'm like, obviously, you've never heard a tree is a tree. And he didn't even know what I was talking about. So, honestly, yeah, I've been second-guessed, I've been undermined, my DP pretty much got me fired from the movie by handing over footage. It was just ugly. And, you know, it was all these young boys who really didn't like being told what to do by a woman. And the film was called Prepper's Grove. It didn't get finished. The producers ran out of money. I mean, I would have been willing to work with them, but
yeah,
also pretty nasty men that were not very kind. And I worked my butt off, and anybody who was on the crew would tell you that I did. But I haven't had a great time working in the Midwest in films at all.
Wow.
And there's a lot of jealousy. A lot of people like to, you know, think, oh, well, you know, you were lucky, or you were born with a silver spoon in your mouth, which I wasn't. You were married to so-and-so, so that's why you got those jobs, when they don't even look to see, like, oh, wait, she did those jobs before she even met that person. And, you know, you get pigeonholed. You know, I'm known as, like, around town by a certain sect of people as the actress who used to be married to the guy who made Candyman, where that's not even who I am. I mean,
right.
He made Candyman 10 years before we met. I'd made films that had, you know, aired internationally when we met. Obviously, you know, somebody that accomplished isn't going to pick somebody to be their spouse who is, like, just some dumb blonde, you know? So it's kind of been ugly. And, you know, I was a little trepidatious about even coming here today because I don't have a ton of great things to say about being a female filmmaker in Grand Rapids, Michigan. In L.A., I did great. London, awesome. I mean, I can't say enough about my experiences in those two major cities. But
no, you can talk about anything.
Well?
Anything.
Yeah.
So I remember talking to Amy Heckerling, I think her name was. She did, Clueless?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. She was talking about, you know, the good old boys club in L.A. That's why I thought maybe you experienced that too. But she came up, like, against what it sounds like the same thing you did in the Midwest. So maybe it's just everywhere.
I'm sure it's everywhere.
Yeah.
My worst experience in L.A. was a comment that a woman made. It was that I was on a bi-coastal conference call with some people from New Line, and I was in L.A., and we were talking to some heads of New Line in New York, and I had, what had happened is I produced Snuff Movie, and we were supposed to do two more films with Donald Kushner, Brad Wyman, and Peter Locke. So my husband at the time was hired out from that contract to make a film for New Line, which would have been a great career move for him. But I was like, well, hey, we had a three-picture deal. What, I mean, like, I come along as this producer. And they're like, well, why should we let you do that kind of thing? And I'm like, because I produced this movie, I'm producing this movie, we have these other projects together, and you've just taken away, if he takes this deal, then my producing job, you know, that's my, you're basically canceling two pictures that I'm supposed to produce. So I need some recompense. And they, at the end of the meeting, or at the end of the whatever, this woman said to me, well, isn't that just what the wife of a director should do? I'm sorry. Isn't that just what a good wife of a director should do? I'm like,
no.
What? Just yeah, because they were like, well, we don't have any problem paying you, but we don't want to give you credit. And I was like, okay, so let me get this straight. You want me to do the producing work, but you don't want to credit me, and you don't mind paying me for it, but you don't want to credit me. What is wrong? But it wasn't a man saying it. It was a woman. Sarah Rose, by the way. That was her name.
I'll
throw her under the bus. I mean, you know, women need to have each other's backs.
Yeah.
They really do. They really do. You know, yeah, I ran into a couple of old men who were like, ha ha ha, making those comments, you know, like the kind of sexist things. But it was really few and far between. Really, I mean, it wasn't like you think. There is a boys' club in Hollywood, for sure. I mean, there is. And there is a certain amount of, like, I don't want to, because I have three older brothers. I grew up in a male-dominated household. I've just never felt I was inferior. You know, I saw all their foibles and their mistakes. I've never felt like that men were somehow the superior sex, you know? It wasn't part of my makeup, you know? And I've always had guy friends, you know? I was in a sorority in college, but I actually hung out, like, with my fraternity friends more. I'm kind of like, you know, that's just my thing. I don't want to be that, like, kind of person who's like, no, I hate men, you know? It's not like that at all.
Right.
So,
right.
I don't know where I was going with that, but I just didn't find it that bad in Hollywood. There is a certain amount of just everywhere you go. Doesn't matter if it's your high school theater department or college, you've got the guys in charge who are the technical guys who know how to run cameras, and I mean, I know how to run cameras too. I was a photojournalist at a newspaper for, you know, 5 years, so I know all about cameras, but there's a certain thing of, like, so you've got these guys who know technical stuff, you know, deciding who's going to be in their film. So girls, if they want to be involved in films, they've got to audition. So it's kind of been divided like that, and it shouldn't be. I think more females from a young age should be given cameras and should be told, hey, you can make a film too. And they are. And all this is changing. This isn't just going to be, you know, I think maybe because back in the day, it involved, you know, filmmaking involved chemicals, and it was very technical. It was highly technical. It was a vocation. It wasn't an art. My ex-husband, who's from Britain, from the UK, he got his film degree, but it was a vocational degree, because what you're doing, you're learning how to work with chemicals. You're cutting actual celluloid and putting it together with rubber cement, you know. So I guess it started out as kind of like didn't really even start as a man's thing, because there were lots of women in the 20s who were making films.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just at one point it kind of got turned into, like, we're men, we tell the stories, and you're women, you audition to be in them, you know?
Yeah. How did that even happen?
Well,
yeah.
Didn't really even happen that way, because a lot of the so-called typists were actually writing the scripts, let's be honest. You know, the cigar-smoking dudes, you know, and they're, like, talking away about their ideas, but...
Maybe it's because they have the money.
Yeah, maybe, but talking about an idea isn't writing it, okay?
No.
Talking about an idea is just what you do when you sit down to collaborate with somebody. The person pecking out the individual, you know, notes on the typewriter, that's the writer. And if you saw Trumbo, did you see Trumbo?
Mm-hmm.
Good film. I mean, he's got his This guy's writing on his typewriter in the bathtub. It's Bryan Cranston.
I love him.
Won Oscar a couple years ago, so okay. It's definitely a good one to check out. I like it because I'm a writer, so. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what happened with me. I started out in Hollywood, you know, to co-writing a screenplay, and then that, you know, Ivan's Ecstasy did really well on the festival circuit. I mean, it played Toronto, it played Berlin in competition. We did a digital sidebar at Cannes. We showed it at Sundance before they allowed digital films. I mean, it played major festivals, Mill Valley, Santa Barbara, Jerusalem. It won the Boston Independent Film Festival. This was my first one out of the gate. So my ex-husband and I got hired as a writing team a lot. For a while, it was just one screenplay after another, and I made more in Hollywood writing screenplays that never got made than I have like on any of the films that actually have gotten made, because I've only made independent films, and as we all know, they're not incredibly lucrative. Mm-hmm. It's hard to get any kind of backing, even if you finished it quite successfully. It's hard to get backing to put it out there. P&A, prints and advertising. So they, I guess it's not prints anymore, but you know, the advertising budgets, I mean, are just huge for studio movies. So where do you even, you know, you have to really depend on the real cinephiles to be your audience, and the people who really seek out every film. They're out there. Mm-hmm. They're out there, but like I said, it's not incredibly lucrative. It's hard to raise a family on the income. So it's been a challenge.
Why do it? What drives you?
It's not even a choice. I mean, it's not a choice. I was writing stories, telling stories, making books with photos in them since the age of, I can't even remember. You know, people are either storytellers or they're not. And that's why, because you either have a story to tell or you don't. And it's an obsession, it's a compulsion. It's not a choice. If I had a choice to go back and do everything all over again, I don't think I would do it any other way. I've had some ups and downs. And sometimes, you know, I have a saying, like, whether they're making, like, you know, a couple $100,000 a year or $12,000 a year, which happened while I was married, both, but they're still the same people. Still kind of eating the same, still eating tuna out of a can, I say. You know, it doesn't matter. Like, money doesn't change who you are. So, you know, as long as we don't have debtor's prison, I guess I'm okay.
I'm sure they'll bring that back.
Uh-oh.
No, I'm being very cynical.
Yeah, well, that's the political climate these days.
Yeah. Yeah.
Was there anything else? I feel like I
Well, I'm interested in, I always wondered, so a person goes to Hollywood or to LA or wherever, and how on earth do you write your film first and then you try to get the funding, or do you talk to people and give them this idea and they go, wow, we love this, we will help you? How did you get people involved with your first film?
Well, the first part of your question is how do you do it this way or do you do it that way? And the answer is yes.
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 Mm-hmm.
Any way you can.
Right.
Any way you can. I mean, there are people who say, oh, you've got to do it this way. I love all these master classes online. I'm just like, okay, you know what? Don't you guys have enough money? Why don't you let teachers teach and you guys can, go back to making your films or whatever, making your millions or... Like, Ron Howard, I'm not paying you any money to tell me how to be a filmmaker. You are Opie Taylor, okay?
You'll never give that down, ever.
Well, right. But you know what? You don't know because you fought your way into the business. You know because you came up in the business, Ron Howard. And I love Ron Howard films, and I love everything he's ever been involved in. But I'm just saying, like, mm-hmm. You know, I have to be honest, Victoria, there's a lot of luck involved. There was a lot of luck in my career, just meeting the right people at the right time, being involved in like a digital film movement, like on the very cusp of it. I mean, I was on the cover of Videography magazine in year 2000. I was featured in Yahoo Internet Life. I'm sorry. I was featured in Yahoo Internet Life. So it was like, I kind of rode a bit of a wave because other people weren't doing that. There were Luddites who were like, film,
the purists.
Yes. And I was just like, well, however we get these stories told. And I think that's where my business degree came in. I'm like, well, it's business, it's film. They don't call it show. That's what Woody Allen says. They call it show. It's show business. And business always goes towards what's the most efficient. And the, you know, if film cans cost X amount to ship around the world, and you can, at that point, send a digital videotape somewhere, you're going to, your profit, you've just, you know, your profit margin is big. And now we're like beaming them all over the place, you know, by satellite. Obviously, it was going to go in that direction. And people who thought it wasn't, people who thought that film was going to stay the standard, they were really unrealistic. I mean, I had this website around the year 2000 called filmisdead.com. I had bumper stickers. We went to the Cannes Film Festival and put up Le Film est mort. We had like stickers on, you know, the Kodak booth. We were renegades. We were rebels. We did guerrilla marketing in Times Square. I hope that the graffiti police don't come and arrest me now. It's 20 years later, but I don't know. I mean, I also had the great experience of working for an ad agency, one of the premier ad agencies, the ones that did all the Nike commercials in the mid-90s. And they were really big into guerrilla marketing. So I drew on some of my other experiences to kind of help market. Now it's just, you're just drowning in a sea of people self-promoting, and not that there's anything wrong with it. I've been there, but I'm just getting tired of it. All the social media and just you know, film. And there's so many channels. There's so many places to see it. There's so many different formats now. It's great on one hand, but on the other, it makes it even more difficult for your stuff to be seen. Yeah. When I made Ivan's Ecstasy, only 1,000 movies were made that year. Came out in, 2002. Mm-hmm. 1,000 movies. Now it's like, probably millions every year. Mm. Probably just millions on YouTube. So now you really kind of need a name. You need some very, you need a big celebrity, or you need some kind of cause to hang it on, because it's just difficult. Catchy ad campaigns just aren't really going to do it. So there's a lot more product, there's a lot more people doing it. Mm-hmm. So I think that it's, and that's great. I mean, it's kind of like what Andy Warhol was predicting. Like, in the future, we're all gonna be stars. We're all gonna.
15 minutes.
Yeah, exactly. So we're there, and like I said, turning it around, coming back to like the positive things. The young people, females especially, they're given these tools. The kids these days. I have two kids. My daughter is gonna be 17 this month. Wow, in a few days. And she made her first film when she was like 12 or 13. She was 12. And she just knew how to do it, because they give them iPads, they have to make video presentations at school now.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes, they
That's
do.
Awesome.
They so they know how to edit. They they have these apps on their phones. I mean, we're coming into a new age, and gender should never enhance your chances of winning, and it should never be a hindrance. Male and female brains despite what a lot of people say, are exceedingly more similar than they are different. And the idea that, you know, men are the storytellers and women get to have to try out to be in the stories is, mm-hmm. it's just gotta stop.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel I've probably been criticized, not so much to my face, but for, you know, I've cast myself in movies that I've produced or directed. And the reason I've done that is to remain attached to them, because a lot of the time, and someone rather famous gave me this advice, a woman named Julia Phillips, who, Julia Phillips was an Oscar-winning producer by the time she was 29 for The Sting. She also produced Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
Wow.
Yeah, she had a great resume. I think Taxi Driver was another one. So I met her when I was making my second documentary for A&E Network. I interviewed her because of her involvement with Taxi Driver. That particular film was called Copycat Crimes. And it was anti-censorship essay on violence in films. And one of her great lines is, well, we just make the movies. We don't sell them the guns.
Yeah.
We just make the movies. We don't sell them the guns. Why should filmmakers be held responsible?
Right.
So she and I really clicked. And she gave me a couple signed copies of her book. It was called You'll Never Eat Lunch in This Town Again. Do you remember that book?
It sounds so familiar.
Yeah, well, Julia Phillips wrote it, You'll Never Eat Lunch in This Town Again. It was kind of a tell-all of her time hanging out with Spielberg and in running around to meetings in Hollywood. And she gave me the advice. She's like, listen, there is no place in Hollywood right now for any females unless you're the starlet. Be the starlet. If you want to be heard, you want to be seen, be in your movies, and otherwise you'll get pushed to the side.
Wow.
I took the advice to heart, and I'm like, you know what? Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't want to be.
Plus, you can act.
I mean,
it's not like
act.
You can't
I know,
act.
That's true. Thank you. Exactly. Plus,
right.
I can act. And it was never really. I mean, I wanted to be an actress when I was a real little girl, but to me the real power was, the power to change people's lives is telling a story. Not that a good performance doesn't enhance that, but it is the story. And the only thing that ever brings Hollywood to its knees is a writer's strike. When the writers go on strike, then Hollywood doesn't know what to do. They need more writers, but they need writers who know how to tell the stories. And when my union, the Writers Guild of America, goes on, you know, threatens strike, they listen, and our fees go up. Kind of priced myself out of any kind of market in the Midwest. People expect you to write scripts for free here.
Yeah, and act for free.
Absolutely. Right. So, mm-hmm. I'm acting for gift cards tomorrow.
Gift cards. Oh, okay, I got
Probably
you.
Probably some tax thing, you know. We can't pay you, but we can give you a
gift card. I think
yeah.
I still have a
yeah.
a gas gift card from one of my...
That's right.
Yeah, I have to find the code it's in.
Yeah, that's funny.
Mm-hmm. So tell me, the last film that you made, you changed the title. What's the title?
Well, the last film that I made was, that I was the director of, was Prepper's Grove, and that didn't get finished.
The one before that, then? The one that
State
you were
in? State of Modern Love.
Yes.
The State
yes.
of Modern Love.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Which I affectionately refer to as Modern Love. Kind of a homage to Bowie, because I like that song. What about it? What do you want to know about it? You saw it, right?
I did.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
That's right.
So tell me about the whole experience of you wrote it, you directed it, you were in it, produced it, right? I mean, you were like the...
I just made it myself. Basically.
You made it yourself, right?
Yeah.
Right.
I had a little help. I mean, I had a part-time cameraman who decided to take on a stage directing job while I was shooting it, so I ended up just finishing up being the co-DP myself. So yeah, I shot that, and first of all, I wrote it. I thought about the premise for about a year, and then I actually put pen to paper, or fingers to keypad. It took me about 6 weeks. And I did what you're never supposed to do, which I did, I also did with Ivan Sexy's, shot the first draft. I let the actors kind of make, not really make the changes, because there weren't any changes to the script, but, you know, I just kind of let them make the dialogue their own, and it worked really well. I mean, I'm very proud of that film. I entered a couple of film festivals. I mean, I won the Melbourne Underground Film Festival in my category, which is international films, and I got a Best Director Award as well. So that's kind of exciting.
Yeah.
That film is going to be released on a digital platform by a company called Global Digital Releasing, I believe. We haven't totally inked the deal yet, but they're going to take that film and Ivan's Ecstasy, and they also want Snuff Movie too. So the three films that I've had played the female lead in will all be kind of packaged and marketed together. Which, thank you, Julia Phillips, for your advice. Otherwise, you know, it would just be like, oh, those films belong to whoever else was involved, probably a man. But
so when you say they're packaged, now, how are they going to be distributed? You said digitally.
Digitally, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You mean like Netflix, or do you mean...
I don't know. I mean, that's really... Yeah, they do that. Mm-hmm. They take them to Netflix or to Hulu or Amazon, exactly.
Mm-hmm. So you don't know yet. Okay.
I really don't know yet. No. But it's exciting. And
yeah.
The Snuff Movie one is a little tricky because that one, I got paid quite substantially to make that film, so I don't own it. And the other two I do. So
okay.
I have to kind of work out a deal with the producers who do own it to see if they mind, because it was never distributed in the U.S. It came out in Europe pretty big. I lived over there at the time, so I mean, it didn't really matter that to me. I guess I didn't even think about whether it came out in the States at that time. I was kind of glad it didn't. It's pretty risque.
Oh.
Can be. I'll send you the link.
Okay. I would like that.
Yeah. It's fun. I mean, for a horror movie. It had great effects. It's the same effects team who did the monster effects, and that made Charlize Theron look so different.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
So they were great. You know some big guns. You know a lot of people.
You know,
people.
I do.
Yeah,
I know
do.
A lot of people. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of famous people, oddly. And...
It's so odd.
It's weird. It is odd.
I know.
But if you live in L.A. and London, and you go back and forth, and then you go to these same film markets around the world, mm-hmm. like the Cannes Film Festival, Berlin, Toronto, AFM, you see the same people.
Okay. Sure.
So you get to know them. And those aren't the famous people, but, you know.
So, I mean, it's a bonus that you know these famous people, but why not? They're just people, right?
That's right. Yeah,
so,
I know
we
some...
We keep forgetting that.
Yeah, no, I know some famous people, knew them before they were famous. I'm acquainted with quite a few, acquaintance of quite a few famous people. I've had great stories about, meeting, Jerry Seinfeld, David Schwimmer, people who were, on TV at the height of their thing, and you just would be at functions with these people
mm-hmm.
and getting in conversations, or you'd see them on the street in West Hollywood, or you would just, I don't know, I've had...
It is kind of weird, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, I donated a work of art to some auction in L.A.,
yeah.
And I went to, the silent auction, and I could swear I saw Michelle Pfeiffer, and I thought, oh my God, she's really small. That's so weird.
Well, that's,
but they're just people, And I saw Mike Myers too from afar,
did you?
And I thought, wow, that's so weird that you see these famous people,
mm-hmm.
but where else are they going to live?
I remember Selma Hayek came to the premiere of Ivan's Ecstasy, and I didn't recognize her without makeup on. And I'm just like, who is she? I was like, who is that over there? She was kind of sitting at the at the bar by herself, because we had kind of like a little cocktail area, and then the screening was out in some studios in like in the Hancock Park area. Anyway, I was like, I didn't even know it was her until I read like the trades the next day. I'm like, what, Selma Hayek? But that was her with Valeria? Oh my God, I did not know that.
Could have said hi, you know, I could have made her make you feel welcome, and you didn't.
No, no, I was
because
like,
she wasn't wearing makeup.
Yeah, so, yeah, I didn't even.
Yeah, that is weird.
I had no idea.
Makeup just does amazing, amazing things.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I don't know why I just picked on Selma Hayek. I can't even recognize her without her makeup on.
That's
now I
hysterical.
Feel like just a bitchy woman.
No, it's funny. It is funny. So what do you have coming up? Are you working on another script?
I'm always working on something. It's just so hard to deliver films to distributors. They give you this long list of things, and you're looking at it like it might as well be written in Chinese, you know?
Like what long list of things?
Well, just all the things that they need, you know, they need stems and M&Es, and I know what all these things mean, but it's just it's just a matter of getting it all to them technically the way they need it, and that's why I needed Doug Remtima, and I don't even know if I'm saying his last name correctly, but
I don't know who it is. So.
Well,
I'm not in the know.
No, okay. he was helping me.
Oh, okay. So this is your remaster. Okay, so this is the Ivan Ecstasy that you're
Ivan's working. Ecstasy, okay. State of Modern Love, and then I'm going to have to do the same
thing. Okay, so those are the three, but do you have anything else that you're planning on filming, or do you have any projects that you're thinking of? Or?
Well, I'm attached to a screenplay that is supposed to shoot in the submarine that's docked in Muskegon.
What is this about?
I don't know if I'm really at liberty to discuss it, but suffice it to say, I'm very hopeful that the money comes through for that project.
Are you a director or are you
directing
acting?
It.
Oh, okay.
I'm directing.
Okay.
I'm also in a web series right now and was just kind of casting it out of the blue, and that's called Not Fired. I know.
I love it.
Yeah, I'm playing a bitchy mom.
Cool.
And, you know, I'm always writing something.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not really sure what my next film is going to be that I write and direct, but I can tell you it's going to be really good.
Oh, of course. I would expect nothing less.
No. No, I have kind of a crime thriller that I'm crafting in there. But like I said, the last film that I made, I had to think about it for about a year before I sat down and wrote it.
It's like has to percolate.
Well, I don't like to write something until I've figured out what the end is.
Ah.
Otherwise, you can write yourself into a corner, you know?
Yeah.
You can write yourself into circles. You can write all day long and you can write for years and not get to the end. So I like to figure out the end before I begin. That way I know where I'm headed. And that's the advice I'd give anybody who's sitting down to write a screenplay.
Interesting. I've never heard that. It's very valuable.
Yeah. Otherwise, you know, why do all that writing? It's just kind of, masturbatory.
Mm-hmm.
You know what they say about masturbation and procrastination.
No, I don't. Now you have to tell me.
Well, it feels good at the time, but in the end, you're only doing it to yourself. So. Sorry.
No.
Had to go there.
That's fine.
All right.
We've got you on tape saying that, so it's cool. This whole thing.
That was the very PG, non-R-rated version of that joke. Anyway.
No, I never knew that, so.
Okay.
I mean, I know, but I didn't know there was an actual... Yeah. So tell me about your trip. I mean, you just took off one day. I looked on Facebook and you were in Paris. I thought, how did that even happen? She was trying to sell a boat. Last I heard, she was trying to sell a boat. And now she's in, she must have sold the boat.
Well, I didn't sell the boat.
Oh.
But I went anyway.
Okay,
and
okay.
I ended up selling the boat when I got back.
There you go.
Yeah. Well, you know, I just, you know, I've been, I really like to get to Europe frequently. I feel like if I'm in the U.S. too long, I'm kind of in a bubble. I feel like I don't have good access to, I don't even want to really get into it. I'm not saying that we have fake news here. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that
we do have fake news.
I learned from living in London for a couple years and traveling around Europe that a lot of the time what you're hearing on the news kind of, it panders to whoever the population is. And I was really surprised when the kind of Iraq war broke out to hear that Sky News in London was kind of telling a different story than Sky News in Germany. Because I traveled between the two places. When I came all the way over to Los Angeles, also, I mean, like the same week, and there was like a third story. So news is very much, I'm not blaming any journalists on the ground, because, you know, I was a photojournalist at a AP newspaper, you know, so I understand journalism and what it is, and, you know, and what happens is that, like, when you work in an AP newsroom, you get all of the Associated Press articles over, you know, the wire every morning. You come in, there's a closed door meeting between the publisher and the managing editor and the news editor, and they decide what's going on the front page. I mean, there might be like 100 stories, and there might be, you know, there's stuff going on everywhere in the world, something earth-shattering going on in the world every day of the year, and in you know, it's no accident that what's in the New York Times is going to be the lead story, and like these newspapers, and what's in the Guardian is going to be also the lead, or the Times of London is going to be the lead story in these other newspapers. I mean, there's no, I don't mean conspiracy here. It's just that there are people deciding these things. I mean, there's
people who own the newspapers.
People who own the newspapers.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Deciding these things. And I think we all know, we've heard, like, what, there's like 6 or 7 companies that own most of the media outlets in the United States. That's why things like public television and viewer-supported anything, listener-supported anything is far more palatable than stuff that you have to get by advertisers. Because in the end, what people are doing when they're, you know, running a news station is, especially in the U.S., because this is not true of the BBC, but in the U.S., it's all about ratings, because you're selling advertising space, and your news has to be just as sensational as your competitors, otherwise you are not going to get those big car ads or whatever. And so what we're really doing is we're disguising entertainment. It is entertainment. People find the news entertaining. They find newsy subjects entertaining. I remember when Walter Cronkite used to just kind of like read a report with like in front on a brown desk, and everything was like, and that was the news. I mean, I'm not saying that that was any less control, but I think we had fewer ways of getting news back then. Now, I mean, we have journalists all over the world. Anybody with an iPhone is a journalist. Anybody on the front lines in Gaza, or, you know, in Syria, or anybody can be, you know, telling these stories with pictures, and there's so much to choose from, it's almost like it's out of control. And that's why I said I like to go to Europe, because having lived there, I just noticed that the news is just a little bit different. I get a little bit better perspective of how things are going. In, you know, there's so much closer to any of that Middle East action too, and somewhere like Italy, where I just wasn't they're really feeling the effects of all those refugees coming in. Well, we don't think about that. I mean, we're, you know, we've got our people, you know, griping about Mexicans. How would they feel if, you know, Italy was dropping bombs on Mexico and so all the Mexicans were coming over the border? We'd be pretty mad at Italy, right? We'd say, why are you over from over there across the pond dropping bombs on our continent? This makes no sense. You're causing a huge problem for us. And that's kind of what, you know, where the Italians that I talked to were at. We're like, what's going on? You know, us and Germany are getting the brunt of this refugee crisis, and nobody's really thinking about it. And the sanctions against Russia actually cost a lot for the Italian economy, because, you know, they're obviously trading with them. And I think Americans are we're geographically isolated anyway. We're geographically isolated from the blowback, from the repercussions of what we're doing.
Yeah.
So, I have friends in Europe, and I just like to, I have expat friends. I got people who won't come back until a certain president isn't president anymore.
I'm trying to figure out how to get away.
Yeah. Yeah. Well.
Yeah. Seriously. Oh my God.
So, I mean, I went to visit, and their perspective is really a lot different than most people who are, you know, living here the whole time and not really delving into those kind of issues.
You stayed with friends. It wasn't like you were a tourist, right? I mean,
yeah.
You went over there to, kind of like recharge.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
I have a couple of friends that I've known for years who, you know, one of whom has an apartment in Paris, and he's a photojournalist that I've known since I made Ivan's Ecstasy. I met him at the Santa Barbara Film Festival in 2001. And then another friend was a family that my kids went to camp with their kids at Camp Minnewanka, Shelby.
Oh,
and
my goodness. Okay.
They were living in Chicago, and they moved over to Italy too, just to get away from this kind of...
But now Italy's having a problem with this too. I mean, I've been seeing little articles here and there about them kind of getting that fascism, or, I mean, it's kind of, you know.
I don't know. I mean, I'd just be wary of anything you read about another country. If you can befriend people who live there and get their perspective on it, it's much better, I think.
Yeah, that's very true. Very true.
Yeah, I'm pretty skeptical of most of the news articles I read. I've just seen journalism change since I started doing, since I was a photojournalist at the Ludington Daily News, actually, for 4 years, and I saw it all change. When I first moved back to Michigan after L.A., I mean, that was my job. I was able to kind of raise my kids as a single mom into small-town journalism, still tell stories, still use my, my skills as a, you know, photographer, and writing. That taught me to be a real quick writer, actually. Mm-hmm. But news has changed a lot even since then, and that wasn't all that many years ago, about 10 years ago.
Wow. So, yeah, it just keeps changing.
It does keep changing. Changing, and not necessarily for the better. What I see now is it's like crazy. I see articles where, like, no sources are even cited, and there's this thing called news aggregators.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what is that even? So, I mean, you have all these news articles that come over the wire, the AP wire. They're like 1,200 words long. And then you've got TV talking about the first paragraph of every, you know, that's it. You don't, you know, reading the news is so much, reading unedited journalist reports is so much more beneficial than listening to people just talk about it. You know, there's all this conjecture and theory and
opinions.
Mm-hmm. Just talking about a headline, and it's just like, you know what, can just we go back to Walter Cronkite reading the whole article, or what whatever it is. I don't care how boring it is, but yeah, or
the
read it yourself.
Attention spans are so much shorter.
Everything has to look like a used car ad. Why? Television, you know, this stuff masquerading as news, like it's like sold to you, like come on down, you know. It's got this flashy graphics, and it's like, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, the graphics guy's getting paid pretty well for that.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah. Well, whatever. It's just disgusting. It's ugly. It's made to get, you know, catch your eye. I don't watch it. I haven't had television in my house for years. Maybe we have a TV, but
I don't either.
I mean, it's Netflix or Hulu or YouTube or, you know, I just don't even care what they're trying to program, you know. Just haven't watched it. Not that, you know, viewer supported or public television is a bad thing.
Totally different.
It's totally different. Yeah. But that the stuff that's paid for by advertising, it's all meant to get more viewers. It's not done to tell you a story that you even need to hear. It's just kind of giving you what you want, you know. It's like spoon feeding you. You know, I don't really want to. I know a lot of people get a lot out of their shows that they watch, This Is Us or Game of Thrones or
I never even
Stranger
that.
Things. I know, I don't either, but I know these are the these are the whatever the flavor du jour, so to speak. But.